As you start a new painter project, the most important setting here is the one which says compute tangent space per fragment. In short, if you are using Unreal Engine, you need to set it to on, and if you are using Unity, you need to set it to off. To further elaborate, the documentation describes it as, if enabled, the normal, tangent, and binormals will be computed in the pixel shader, which in itself does not really say much since it is a common shading technique which encapsulates a vast number of visual factors and programming techniques. It doesn't really explain what it does differently to make the textures specifically compatible with Unreal Engine 4, rather than any other rendering environment which also uses cross-product by tangent calculations in the pixel or fragmentation shader. Looking at published SIGGRAPH documents and Epic Games' senior graphic programmer Brian Carey's blog, it seems Unreal Engine uses a bidirectional reflectance distribution function that is a mishmash of different standards, so it is possible that the button is set to make the textures compatible against that specific function. If that is the case, then the documentation description seems to add to the confusion, as it could simply imply a Phong or GGX shader. But Unity uses GGX as well, so we know that is not the case. So for now, if you are using Unreal Engine 4, you need to leave it on, and if you're using anything else, you need to leave it off. Moving back to the top, you find a set of templates. Templates loads in different shader models and sets up a bunch of shader channels to send data over to said shader model. These channels can be found listed under the texture set setting, where you can add and remove channels as you wish to fit any special needs. The templates are set up to work with the majority of the popular rendering environments, so it is rare that you will find a need to do so. Most of the templates has a PBR prefix to its name, which is an acronym for physically based rendering. Most of the major licensing game engines these days uses PBR shaders, but there is no set in stone ways of interpreting the data, and thus most game engines and other rendering environments use their own methods of doing so. The PBR templates are not really vital when it comes to exporting textures out of Painter, as it can convert maps back and forth to suit any export needs, indifferent to which template has been used to actually create them. However, it is convenient to stick to one template over time, especially when you start making smart materials. This is because the layer channels will only connect to texture set channels it has been set up for. So a layer which has been set up for a roughness channel in a albedo metallic roughness template will not automatically invert the roughness channel input and plug itself into the glossiness channel within a albedo metallic glossiness template. By sticking to one template, all your smart materials will work together without sabotaging the layer hierarchy. So even if you'll eventually export for Unity, which uses a albedo metallic glossiness model, you can just as well use the albedo metallic roughness template, which is used in Unreal Engine 4, and vice versa. The normal map format allows you to choose between the OpenGL method and the DirectX method for interpreting the tangent Y value of the vertex normal. OpenGL and DirectX interpret the tangent Y value oppositely. So what this normal map format really asks is if the tangent Y value 1.0 means upwards or downwards. If the texturing environment is set to a OpenGL method and has the normal map baked against that specific orientation, a DirectX rendering environment will shade the surface as if the light entered from the opposite direction, because it interprets the value oppositely. Most rendering environments gives the user the option to flip the tangent float value, so this setting is not really vital, but it is convenient for the artist to get this right the first time, so the flipping switch will not be necessary later. So if your rendering environment uses OpenGL, use the OpenGL method, and vice versa. Next up is the Create a Texture Set per UDIM Tile checkbox. If you don't know what UDIM is, then you are not using it and you should set this to disabled. But to keep it short, the UDIMM workflow creates additional UV ranges outside the usual single UV range. And the artist can then place UV islands into these other ranges and create textures unique to them without having to assign them to unique materials. The textures will not repeat, mirror, or clamp outside the ranges as they usually do. The convenience of UDIMM is that it allows the artist to easily work with multiple smaller sets of textures, which combine into a single UV range, would create a much larger and computationally intensive texture. For instance, instead of working on a 16K by 16K texture, the artist can instead work with 8 2048 by 2048 textures without creating 8 different materials and clutter the material hierarchy within the modeling software. Painter will create a texture set for each UV range that has a UV island in it, so in this case it would create 8 texture sets. Not all rendering environments support it, so you will have to look that up before deciding on using this method. The document resolution sets the amount of texels generated within the width and height of the UV range. In other words, it sets the resolution of the texture. Take note, this has nothing to do with the texture resolution of the baked textures. It only has to do with the resolution of the textures in the layer stack. The size of the baked textures will be decided in the bake window later on. Finally, if you have used any other programs to bake textures, these can be imported and connected to the texture set to have a visual effect across the model's geometry and also be used as baking data within Painter to further generate texture types. For it to be self-assigned to the various texture sets, the naming convention displayed on screen needs to be followed. First, you need to write the name of the texture set, or the material within your modeling software, followed by an underscore and the texture type name in small letters and separated by underscores where needed. If you don't follow this naming convention, the texture files can be found within the textures shelf, where you can connect them yourself by dragging them into the texture set setting. Since I am primarily an Unreal Engine user, I will select the DirectX normal map format and compute tangent space per fragment. If you have made changes to your model within your modeling software, you can reload your model to have these changes take effect in Painter by going to Edit and Project Configurations. Model properties, which can be updated, are the model geometry, UV layout, and materials. But you need to click the Select button, select the file, and open for it to actually reload. Now that the low poly model has been imported, you may start the baking process. You will find a Bake Textures button under the texture set setting. In a panel to the left, you will see a column of buttons which each represents a single texture type, with additional checkboxes within them. The checkboxes lets you decide individually between the texture types whether they will be baked or not. And the two buttons on top lets you quickly enable and disable all the texture types. Moving to the bottom, you can close the baking window, bake all the texture sets with the current setting, or just bake the selected texture set with the current setting. By clicking the buttons themselves, you can adjust the baking setting for said texture type. The default setting for the texture type specific parameters are usually good enough to get you started, so these can be left as is. They are well documented in the online documentation, which is worth a quick read the next time you find some spare time. The most important settings are the ones which are found in the common category up top, as these are settings which affect all the texture types across the board. The output size is the texel density of the baked textures, so each texture type which is set to bake will be generated at this texture resolution. Dilation width clamps the color past the UV island border in the amount of pixels set by this parameter. This helps eliminating MIPMAP compression errors, filling holes in the textures as a result of UV skewing, and more. The higher resolution the texture, the higher this number should be to compensate. The applied fusion button will interpolate the edge colors of the UV islands and create connected gradients between them until it fills all of the empty UV space. Dilation width, on the other hand, clamps the solid color without the gradient behavior, and it is only to a set texel amount. If applied fusion is on, the dilation width parameter has no meaningful function and can just as well be left at the default 1 value. This is where you will reference your high poly sources to bake from. If you click on the file icon to the right, you can add one or as many high poly sources as you want. You can remove them individually with the minus button. The use cage checkbox enables and disables the cage model function. By clicking the file icon, you can navigate to the cage file that you want to use. Shortly explained, a cage model is a projection source reference for the rays that scans the surface of the high poly objects to generate textures which will be projected onto the low poly objects. There is a lot of do's and don'ts with cage models, more than I can compress into this video, so you will have to look up literature and other videos which has been made to explain these more in depth if you have yet to learn of this technique. The max frontal and rear distance sliders sets the ray projection distance from the low poly objects if no cage model has been referenced and enabled. For the baker to be able to see the geometry of the high poly objects and create textures, the high poly surface has to be between the boundary of these two parameters. If the cage checkbox is enabled, these sliders has no function since you are using the cage geometry as a projection source instead. Relative to bounding box sets the max frontal and rear distance parameter to scale relatively to the scale of the entire model instead of the individual objects, so each ray is projected from the exact same distance from each vertex. If a cage is being used, this parameter has no function. The average normal option is also relative to the frontal and rear distance parameter. If it is set to on, the projection ray will be projected on the average angle of the connected faces instead of the perpendicular angle of each face. This sets the angle of the ray cast where both faces are visible even when the connected faces form an angle sharper than 90 degrees. Most of the time, you will want this to be enabled. The ignore backface checkbox tells the baker whether to continue or stop the projection ray when it hits the backside of a polygon. If it is unchecked, the ray will stop, and if it is checked, the ray will continue. This can be used to eliminate some ray projection issues. Match informs the baker whether or not objects within the low poly model should be allowed to scan objects within the high poly model reference that has non-matching names. If it is set to match by name, the projection rays from the object named head, mouth, teeth, low will only scan the object named head, mouth, teeth, high within the high poly model reference. However, the object head, mouth, tongue, high will not be scanned by the rays of the head, mouth, teeth, low object as the name does not fully match. This function was made to eliminate the need to explore the models to prevent projection rays overlapping other unrelated objects. Match by name and the cage work together, so the cages that overlap other objects will not have these foreign objects be visible in the baked textures of the low poly surface. This makes it a lot easier to iterate on a model, since there is no need to re-explore the model and realign it with the high poly model and stuff like that. The high poly model suffix and the low poly model suffix allows you to tell the baker which words to identify when matching the high poly objects to the low poly objects. Take the example mentioned above. Since it is set to underscore high and underscore low, The baker is able to match names of head, mouth, teeth low and head, mouth, teeth high and isolate those two objects. The suffix strings allows you to set the suffix to your own preference, in case you have your own naming convention you like to follow. Take note that the ambient occlusion ray will ignore this setting and occlude light across different objects as per usual. This is because the ambient occlusion uses separate rays for this task. If you don't want to occlude light between objects, this can be disabled in the ambient occlusion texture type setting by setting self-occlusion to only same mesh name. The anti-aliasing method increases the number of text holes in the UV range by a set multiplication to further refine the details during the baking process. It then finds the average color shared between these smaller points and uses it to color the actual text hole. This lessens the zigzaggy look between high color contrast text holes, as they instead use the middle ground within the area. Increasing the anti-aliasing factor will increase the time for the baking procedure. When you are baking your model for the first time, it is wise to turn anti-aliasing to off and disable all the texture types but the normal map. Especially the thickness map takes a long time to be created, and it is a waste of time to wait around for it if it turns out there's something wrong with the projection distance or the cage model. Keeping the texture size at 1024x1024 and the anti-aliasing to none will result in a very jagged texture map. But the only thing you should care about now is that the projection rays does not render foreign objects into parts of the normal map where it doesn't belong, and that the rays are at a far enough distance to see all of the geometry. It is also wise to turn off apply diffusion when doing this, as it will create gradients for the normal map as well, which can hide holes within the normal map. Once you got a successful bake, you can enable all the textures and increase the resolution and anti-aliasing factor to get cleaner textures.